The foundation of human understanding teaches an observation exercise, often called meditation, which permits you to become objective toward your problems and allows your heartaches, bad habits, fears, and anxieties to be completely eliminated from your life without effort on your part. Until you have begun to practice this exercise, much of what you see and hear on the following program may be shocking and upsetting to you. But if you will listen calmly and with an open mind, you may discover the key to the peace of mind and joy for which you've been searching all of your life. And now, from the foundation of human understanding, here is Roy Masters.
Hello. William James said that genius is simply nothing more than observing in an unhabitual way. Observing life without habit. All the bad mental entanglements, emotional prejudices we have. If you could see life with the clarity of a little child, then you wouldn't have any problems. And you don't. You see through your prejudiced eyes. You see through clouded vision. You see through a mist of excuses and hostilities and prejudices and misinformation, a sea of lies. My son was saying, he went to the Price Club, you know where that is, and he said to friends who he's with, well, I won't be long, 20 minutes. So he was about 30 minutes. And there was a young lady with him, accompanying him, and when he came back, he says to the friend who asked where he was, he says, oh, well, I couldn't get served. But they also walked around a little bit, you see. And the girl that was with my son, the young lady that was with my son, never said anything. She says, yes, we couldn't get served. Now, they both lied, didn't they? A little bit. They lied just a little bit. And he observed himself that if you could be supported in 1% of all the lies that are in your life, just that 1%, you're actually reinforcing 100%. Who understands what I just said? If you have anybody agree with you in the smallest, littlest thing, if you can convince somebody that you're generous, or that you're thoughtful, if you can convince anybody of anything, for whatever ego value it has, if they see you in a certain way which you've contrived to make them do, then everything about you, all the lies that you have about you, is everything you are is reinforced, and so is it the case with emotions. One, every little emotion you feel, no matter how small, if you trip over the cat, that emotion, that little resentment, reinforces every little thing about you, all of your bad habits, all of your notions, all of your Christian, Buddhist, whatever it is you're teaching. Everything in that moment is energized. And you, not only is it reinforced, so you walk around the same person, but you're worse. I mean, out of the top of that pops another little syndrome, another little habit pattern. Because it takes energy to make you move and have your being and to develop this inner person. And either the inner person develops from an outer means, a relationship with the environment, stresses, pressures, excitements, stimulations, challenges, etc., etc., or it is uniquely formed from a mysterious process which very few people find, for which reason we're all in conflict with it, which we haven't found. It's there, you see, but we haven't grown from it. So the inner man never grows, the inner woman never grows. This other one grows. The one that grows is the one that grew from some distant trauma. Someone laid a trip on you. You saw your mother in bed with a boyfriend or something like that, and that shock seeded who you are, and from that point onwards you have never drawn a sane breath. And you've lost your genius. The shock traumatized you. and set up the system of continuously reacting to stress and environment in order to exist as that person, because the other person is no longer. The other person exists only as a guilt. The person that might have been. And every time you react, you keep growing. That it's like a seed. An oak tree is a seed. One's once a seed, but if you keep nurturing it with water and sunlight and the proper fertilizers and conditions, it will all of a sudden lose, the seed disappears, and all it takes the form of a tree, and it keeps growing and growing and growing, and with more and more sunlight and more nutrients, it keeps on popping out here and there, right? And so do you. Okay? Now, what we need to do is to understand these processes, and in our continuing series of The Battle of the Mind, I hope, I mean, some of you, are you flashing on things right now? How many people are flashing on things? Wow! So we got the first flasher over there. Please don't flash too much at once. Otherwise, I'm going to have a syndrome and I'll be...
It must be flashing because my heart's beating very fast.
Okay.
I'm very frightened. Are you saying, I had a trauma in my life. First of all, I'm a cigarette smoker.
You am? Or you were?
I am.
Well, we'll fix you tonight.
Maybe that's why I'm standing up. I don't know.
Okay.
I didn't start smoking until I was 29 years old. And I started smoking at a time when I had a trauma. That was when my ex-husband and I divorced. He left me. And I just want to clarify something that I'm not sure about in something you said previous to this is, are you saying that...
I like nice, precise questions. It shows me that you're following and that you want a real answer. You understand?
Yes.
Some people don't give precise questions and I have to sort of invent their question in order to give an answer. Please, thank you.
Okay. If there was something in my life that I hated, that I fell to before, and then I experienced this trauma of my ex-husband and I splitting up, him leaving.
Yes.
Is that how the cigarette smoking got, I started smoking the cigarettes?
You said something about a prior life to your husband. I don't see where that fit into the question.
Okay, I realize I'm trying to be precise.
Can you be more, in other words, are you saying that the onset of cigarette smoking, was that due to the stress of my husband leaving me? Or something prior.
I know that. I believe I am, but I don't know why it was a cigarette smoking. Why didn't I start drinking? Why didn't I go to dope? You know why?
Yes. Well, you could have very well started drinking. It wouldn't make much difference but you may have had an abhorrence to drinking. Maybe let's say you had a father that drank, and you hated anything to do with drinking or detested it, and it revolted you. You may not be a drinker, although you could hate him so much, you could end up becoming just like him. You understand that? Mm-hmm. You could be molded. The identity inside you could grow from that so much. And the more you try not to be like him, the more you like him. Mm-hmm. It happens. You may succeed for a while and eventually give into it and succumb to the very thing that sprung up in you because you've hated it, see?
Neither one of my parents smoked, though. Although I did find out later in life, it was after I started smoking that my mother was secretly smoking.
Ah.
But I didn't find that out till after I had already smoked.
Yes, well, that could have a lot to do with it. But the basic question is, you could have picked up any number of habits, but you chose smoking for whatever reason. It doesn't make much difference. Whatever is available and what is socially acceptable. If you're a rebel, you will choose something that's not socially acceptable. You know, it's a part of your rebellion, right?
I think it was a rebellious thing I did.
But smoking is a rebellion in itself, though. It's an attempt to rebel. It's to fight off the conscience. It's a reinforcement to aid you in not knowing, forgetting your inability to deal with life properly. In other words, it's a way of not knowing. It's a way of rejecting reality. In other words, ego-wise, it's rebellion against knowing. Because whenever we have overreacted to environment, with anger and hate. You can't help but be a real small part of the real us gets displaced, and something, the thing we hate, gets inside us, and we actually become what we hate, and we don't like what's growing up in us, and we don't like to see it, but we don't know how to stop it. So what do? The next best thing is not to see that it's happening, and that's what smoking is, a rebellion against seeing what is happening. It's pride's way of dealing with the problem of looking at ourselves. If it isn't there, then you don't have to feel guilty. See? Or you when you smoke, you actually anesthetize your conscience. And somehow, when that happens, what you're looking at doesn't seem to show up in such stark contrast as to bother you. You can sort of live with it. Don't notice it because there's no contrasting value there.
I remember, I don't know what it was, but I really forced myself to smoke. I remember when...
Well, that's silly.
I know, it was, back then. And now I'm going through a battle with my mind to stop, and it's like I'm struggling with it.
Yes.
And it's like I believe you, I see the truth in your principles you speak, and you say don't smoke, and I wonder why. Well, why don't I not smoke?
Well...
You know?
You see, the trouble is that you need the you that isn't you anymore needs not to see. Because the you that isn't you anymore, if it could see, wouldn't be that you anymore. What is very hard for many people to realize that this imprinting, the self, which I call, it comes from imprinting, from trauma. It's a self that actually grows up inside us like an alien. Just like an alien in the movie The Alien. And it's nurtured by the more of the same emotions and experiences that created it. So in order, once you start to hate, let's say you hate your husband, once you start to hate him, a thing starts growing up inside you that needs to hate. You'll think of him, you'll see a husband and wife just like, who looks like your husband, and you'll resent them for being happy and you're not. You resent your children because it reminds you, your son reminds you of your husband.
You mentioned, Roy, about how...
Well, can I just finish? Mm-hmm. Can I just finish? I just want to make a point that this alien self needs the cover of drinking and smoking. And it is in control of your thinking. You are not. It will give you the excuse. It will give you the compulsion. It will obsess you with something, to look for something to distract, because it cannot tolerate the tormenting light of conscience. It now must survive. It's a survival mechanism of the it that is not you, but the it that you think is you. See? So therefore, it becomes a psychology of thinking. It gets inside, and it starts to control you and to think through you, as if it were you, and because you think it is your thoughts, you follow it. Have you noticed that you cannot change your thoughts? You cannot change a habitual thought, an obsessive idea keeps coming back and back and back, and then you struggle with it, you struggle with it, you struggle with it, and finally you seem to give it more power, don't you? And then you think to yourself, it thinks through you, and you think to yourself, and you think it's you thinking. Well, you know, it must be natural. Is that right? Why fight nature, right? And then you give in to nature. You buy that one, and you give into it. And what have you got? More obsessive thoughts and conscience. And then the thoughts come back to you stronger than ever, sometimes laughing at you. And you experiment with them. Instead of standing back and learning how to deal with them, you don't know how to do that. It makes you afraid to stand back and look because it produces pain. And the pain that you feel is what it feels, but you feel like it's pain, and you feel like you're dying. It's dying, but you think you're dying. And it feels bored because it doesn't have the energy, it hasn't got that connection. It wants you to have a habit. It wants you to go back to lower and lower relationships. It wants you to interact with environment because that's how it got in. And that's how it sustained. It got in through a reaction. A no-no reaction, an initial trauma, and it keeps growing through Well, how can I say this? You could notice that the first time you smoke a cigarette, it tastes horrible. Perhaps you may have to cough and splutter and try to get an acquired taste. But once you start to get the value from it, which is the escape value, and once the it in you begins to slip in under the cover of that night, then strangely enough, the very thing that was abhorrent to you before now becomes attractive. In other words, you start to live in a reverse back-to-front nightmare. See? Where that's what the wicked people of the world want you to do. They want you to experience sexual promiscuity. They want to violate you. They make all the wrong things, the non-spiritual things, the improper, the sins, attractive. And they give you the proper reasons, the appropriate reasoning, which it becomes your reasoning because you don't have anyone to countermand, to override that with enlightened reason, because there aren't hardly any enlightened people in society anymore. And they want you to violate you with this improper degrading act. Now, as an innocent person, you see there's something wrong with that. In this way of, as William James says, you could see things with a genius of uncluttered prejudice, right? Without the clutter of prejudice. In the unhabitual way, right? You see that, but the world keeps crowding in and saying something wrong with you. Why don't you come in? It's fun. Something wrong with you for seeing something wrong with us. And you see everybody's caught up with that. So now you do this degrading act, and lo and behold, you are no longer, you are transformed. You are no longer the same person. And even though you feel guilt about it, which is the nagging of your trailing conscience, the other thinking gets inside and talks to you and always talks you out of doing the right thing. It makes you doubt that what you know about yourself is true. And it makes the forbidden thing even more attractive, because only that way can you can find any relief by losing yourself in that same process, by more sex and more smoking and more drinking. Can you stay ahead of your conscience at the same time feel like you're coming alive and living it up and becoming more of a person when you're becoming more of a jerk? Yes, no. Oh, am I making a point?
Yes. Okay. I've been meditating. I'm a beginning meditator, and I find that as I meditate more, a lot of thoughts come into my mind about it, just like a whirlpool of thoughts just get into me, and I find myself remembering things about my past that kind of I have
reviewing,
a tendency.
Yeah, it's a review.
Yeah, and I had a tendency to cry out of my, it's weird, but my left eye, it almost unconsciously, it just happens where I start to tear, or I don't know whether it's a sign of emotion or
No, with no emotion present, I take it. There was no emotion at that time?
I was still, but yet the tear that I just could not stop just start coming out.
You know what that's called? Repentance. It's a sadness of the soul that has no emotion with it at all. When that process begins, the minute you start to cry, an unemotional tear, not emotional, watch out for the emotion, because that's a false sorry. That's the act for sympathy. Who understands what I'm saying? It's a baby cries to get its own way and to get sympathy. You know, give me love and I'll stop crying.
Roy?
Yeah?
When your soul becomes anesthetized by eating or smoking to try to escape, it's like I have an eating problem. I'm really like a skinny person.
Everybody has an eating problem. There's no such thing as a person without one.
I never do that. Some people.
You know why that is? You have to eat my book, I almost said. Eat my book, Eat No Evil, and it tells you about it in there. It's an excellent book. You've got to be ready for it, though. You've got to be a stout-hearted soul. Okay, go ahead.
It seems as if, like, I notice meditating, I've learned to be more aware. One of the things I've noticed that when I eat, it's usually either it's excitement, egotistical, overwhelming excitement about an event that's really not so significant, but yet it heightens me, you know. Or it's something that if I'm worried or stressed about my expenses or my financial situation or something I did, I'll just eat. And I know, at that moment, I know that it's a way of escaping. I see myself, but yet, like you said, it's like a strong pull into it, and I'll just keep eating.
But you eat sometimes, you eat to reinforce the nature. For instance, I was having a battle with a homosexual on a radio program, and I was really getting to him. And at each station break, of course, it was happened to be in a hotel lobby, and there was a little restaurant next door, and he every station break, he'd rush over there and get some Twinkies or some, you know, pudding and pies and stuff himself in, because that's how he gets mother's love, that's how he gets reinforcement, that's how he gets, it helps him to deny the truth. And it reinforces his fallen identity's argument, strength against me, you see. See, so that's what we use food for. We use alcohol for courage. We use food for courage. A false courage energizes the degraded person. We're all degraded people. There's very little human dignity. Very little human dignity at all.
Why?
Because we don't even know what it is. Yes.
One more thing. When we find ourselves in these habits, and because we meditate, that is the way to hopefully eventually become released from these things that bind us. It's like, also another problem I have is that in the past...
Don't throw too many at me at one time, because we've got to explore one at the time, you know.
Yeah. One more.
No, just...
Well...
All right. You pressured me into it.
Well, I...
Hold on, just saying, before you get to that, because I wanted to say one thing about what we were talking about. On the emotion issue, in terms of repentance, it seemed to me, what I thought of when you said that was the part in the New Testament when Jesus is talking about praying in your room alone. And he said, don't pray in front of other people.
Right.
I think he says something about the fact if you do that, you have your reward. The thing, it seems, what struck me is that if you are in the process of realizing something about yourself and you get caught up in this wonderful emotion that just overtakes you, you're getting your reward. And it seems to me that in a way, all of what we've been talking about...
It's a sham on your own stage.
Yes.
See, it's a sham on your own stage. You feel sorry for yourself.
Yes. That was.
Is that the point you're making?
Yes.
And you got to be very careful, because that could be a drug. Your own emotions that you can invent can pardon? Well, yeah, we'll have to, one second, because...
Oh, one more last thing. In the past, I had made the mistake of making someone a god, a man, and...
Everybody's made that mistake.
Well, I have to suffer. I feel like it hurts. I'm suffering for it.
You take your identity from the process of making somebody a god. The Greeks used to do that with their statues. They were imperfect people, but they were able to make beautiful statues, and they would make these beautiful works of their own hands and bow down and worship it, hoping, of course, imitating a process that we do with one another rather unsuccessfully, because mostly we imbibe the worst of other people, not the best.
How long does one have to suffer?
Until you, the suffering wakes you up. Yeah. Suffering is a very good thing. You don't want to take suffering away from people, because it's the only thing, if they haven't got wisdom, that will make them look for it, right? Okay, thank you very much. And, we got four minutes. These half an hour, go ahead.
Since we have a little time, I was going to add one other thought connecting to the smoking and to the emotion. And that is something that I've heard you talk about in terms of dying to the world. And it seems to me that smoking or anything like that, eating ice cream or anything you can name, is a process of living to the world
maintaining the world.
Maintaining the world. And once we identify with that maintenance, there's this terrible feeling, it seems to me, that if we let that go, there'll be nothing. There's this great black void that we're going to fall into.
Listen,
and that we'll never survive if we give up our ice cream or whatever.
You want to sit here or something? Clip him out. On the editing floor with him. I love it. You see, I have a problem, is that I won't say I was perfect or always innocent all my life, but I really haven't suffered. And the only way I know what I do is slyly picking it out of your brains as I can talk you out of your, pull you out of your hole, and you can confess. I get you to confess all these little things. So I've got, about 45 years of memories, but it's so much better if we have somebody who is stuck in that hole and experienced. I haven't experienced and suffered like most of you have, so he's talking from first-hand experience, and you notice I'm talking from some other space, and when he or somebody else, even my son, starts to talk, they're talking from real gut-level experiences, and you can identify better with them than you can with me. That's why I hope to get most of you to talk, because you embody what I am talking about, and it comes out street language, see? Streetwise. I didn't mean to ignore you, but we're coming to the end of a segment. Bill, could you help me make a commercial? No. Could you help me make a commercial? Yes, how about it? Because I know, I don't know what I'm saying. It sort of blends in with the rest of the program and people don't hear it.
I think you have the way to say it. I think it's important for people just to know about the meditation, but I think you're the one to tell them. So,
well, I just... this marvelous way of seeing life through the eyes of a innocence, where you have this genius that I started out talking about today, is available to you. And I have, well, I don't know if it discovered me. I guess we met halfway. I was searching and I found. Or it was seeking a man who was receptive and I was it, I suppose. But whatever it is, I found a way to help you to see through unprejudiced eyes. So you can see things the way they are without overreacting to what you see, which is a big problem. You see, sometimes you overreact not to see. Anyway, I haven't got time to go into the details. Tomorrow night we'll continue with this trend of thinking, and please write to the foundation and ask for the materials. The information will be on the screen. Thank you very much, and join me tomorrow night.
Part two is next.
Hello, I'm Roy Masters, and we're talking about the mind and the battle for the mind, your own mind. Most people think that they have their own mind, and they think through their own mind, and they make up their own mind, and they decide with their mind, and it isn't true. The truth of the matter is that we are zombies. And of course our pride doesn't like to think that we are anything but, you know, who we are. I was watching a program the other night. It was about death and dying. I just saw a little bit, but I heard enough to make me think, because they were talking about this woman who had this choice about how she should die or whether she'd go on living, and they said, well, it's Josephine's, it's her life. See, and it isn't Josephine's life at all. It isn't our life at all. We don't have a life of our own. There's no such thing. It just doesn't exist. It's a very hard concept to grasp that we're not free moral agents. We may be free immoral agents. We're not free moral agents. There's no such thing as freedom. The choice is, if there's such a choice left, and my concept is that we should be saved from that original choice, which we all share, the Adam and Eve syndrome, sharing a common heritage of being mindless, see, thinking that we are having our own minds, which is a lie, see? So there's only a choice between, you know, being free to do what's right and to live that life from the inner inbreathing of our soul, or to imbibe ourselves, to get down into the world and grab all the gusto you can for this substitute person, which is a creature of culture. And a creature of culture, which is antithetical to that which we were created to be. Culture grabs us, puts its mark in us, puts its imprint, and our love of the world is really this thing's love for what created it, or recreated it. Yes?
Well, I guess that's where we start to get in trouble, is when we get ambitious and start to decide what we want to do with our life, and not think of any higher purpose or what God wants to do with our life.
Yes, well, that's exactly right. It's called selfishness. And it's the selfish side of us that's really wicked. Because if the selfish side of us, that thinks, the part of us that often thinks it's our life to live and do as we want. If it should see the truth for 1 minute, it could not be selfish. It would have to be selfless.
I think that's why most people, most of the time, they have to be caught up with something. You know, you see fat people,
caught up,
you see...
Caught up and caught away from seeing the truth about themselves. People are always caught up away from seeing the truth. They're caught up with something that gives them the illusion that their given nature craves. It craves an identity, an idea, a reinforcement of the lie identity that has made a home in it. Does anybody track what I'm saying? In other words, we're really not ourselves, but we think the self is who we are. So if you're born in Borneo, you'd be a good cannibal. And if you're born in Iran, you'd be a good Ayatollah fellow, whatever you are. And an Ayatonail or whatever you call it. You'd be so ingrown, I suppose. Ooh, that's terrible. But it worked a little bit. And you see, it doesn't make a difference if you're born in a Jewish family, the Jewishness will grab you. If you're born in a Christian family, the Christianness will get you. And then you'll have to go to church, and you'll feel like you're guilty if you don't go to church. And if you're born in an alcoholic environment, well, maybe you feel guilty for not going to the local pub. See, because if you've got to get your reinforcement, you've got to be caught up with something.
Is there a way not to be culturized like that?
Yes. You see, I think, I've always said that civilization, what we call civilization, is really culture. That culture rises as the man, the civilized man.
But is there a way to do that not to your children?
Oh, yes, the only way you can not do it to your children or pass it along, because you must pass it along, you understand. You are under a compulsion to pass. Who can see why we have to pass it along? What is the mechanism of passing it along? Why do we are under a compulsion to pass it along and to impregnate our children with the same vile identity that we have?
It's like to justify it.
Okay, one. Go ahead.
Stroke our egos.
Stroke your ego. Well, justify, stroke ego. What else? No, because the thing which has grown up in us is intolerant of the light that is still in their child. We must put it out to survive. We react to the outside the same way as we react. If the truth is in two places, it's inside us and outside us, inside people. And where it's still intact in other people, it makes us face ourselves and creates pain. So we impulsively move to destroy the pain, and we will destroy our own children's perception by screaming and yelling and upsetting them and projecting us into them and putting their light out. Okay?
But how do you realize what culture you're in if it's not a physical culture?
All cultures are sick. Just remember, there's no such thing as a healthy culture. There are some better than others. I'd rather be in America or in a Jewish home or a Christian home than in being born a cannibal. I mean, some cultures have it within their parameters to hopefully, it was the original intent of the founders, to make a penitentiary, surround you with rules, because if you weren't surrounded by the rules, you'd become more cannibalistic and more... You go more native, go more wild. So they hem you in with rules, the laws and commandments written on stone and parchment. It says no further. See, thou shalt do this and thou shalt do that and thou shalt not do this, in the hope that by constantly reminding you that what you finally awaken to their meaning, and when you finally awaken to their meaning, you no longer need the stones to remind you. Follow that? You will have become restored to the laws within. See? So those are the best of cultures, the Judeo-Christian ethic. And you see what happens when you tear down the Judeo-Christian ethic? That which, as a stern schoolmaster or mistress, surrounds you with herself or himself to say, no further, kids. See, you are a spiritual criminal and you need this wall around you. Otherwise, you'll become like the other nations. You'll become cannibals and degenerates. If you look at the various cultures of the world, you're not looking if you go to Australia and you see the Aborigines and you see them in their aboriginal state, we look at them as creatures who have not yet fully developed. If you take an Aboriginal child, put it in America in a decent home, where he grew up to be a doctor or a lawyer, guarantee you, has nothing to do with his, with being some kind of Neanderthal creature that has not as developed as far as we Westerners. It is the culture that stifles and implants and degrades. It is culture that does it. Even the so-called, you know, noble cultures like Judaism and Christianity, that is, even that can implant an artificial, stifling substitute for what is real. You call them, you make a hypocrite individual rather than a real person. See, that you're surrounded with so many stumbling blocks that keep you from growing as a child of the light. You see. The gentleman has been standing up for a while.
Thank you, Roy. Thank you. I'm Bob, Roy. You brought up alcoholism. I'm an adult child of alcoholics. I've been in the program for 8 months. I've listened to you for the past month, and I found that a lot of your principles coincide with the principles of AA.
Sure they do.
The 12 steps.
The trouble is it becomes a culture within a culture.
Right.
And you become addicted to whatever supports you get to keep you from getting drunk, and therefore you never outgrow them, and they become addicted to the power of it, and they see to it that you never outgrow them, and then the whole purpose of it is destroyed. Is that right?
Yes, that's what I found. And after listening to you, and I got your tapes the other day. I thank you for that. You told me to forget my pride, and I ran over here and got the tapes, and I started meditating, and I did find that.
It release
in myself, yes, that connection with my God, my higher power,
and?
For the first time.
And what happened?
I've been a resentful, angry man all my life.
Why were you angry?
Oh, Jesus.
well, you were the reason. I mean, this...
Anything you want to give
the
me?
The whole world's crazy. Your parents are crazy.
Sure, they were terribly crazy. See, my mother was crazy, my father was a wimp.
You're born into an insane world, and it tries to make you think you're crazy.
Yeah.
And it tries to drive you crazy. And to some degree, it succeeded only because it succeeded in tempting you to hate, to getting you to react. Because once they can get you to react, whether pleasure or pain, it doesn't make it, they can seduce you with music, with excitement, with sex, all the forbiddens, appeal to ego. But if they can establish an emotional connection to your mind, you become one of them. And you don't know how to stop being one of them. And then you hate to see that you're one of them, and you start to drink like them, because the same is in you that was in them that hates to see the truth about itself.
But something has pulled me all my life. I resisted the Catholic Church, I resisted alcoholism, I resisted drugs, I got into them, but something brought
me
out.
Just so long you can resist it.
Hmm?
It's just so long you can resist it. But if you have resentment.
I'm 41 years old. I'm doing better than I've ever done in my life. Yeah. I'm making contact with you, your principles, your form of meditation. And what attracted me to your ideology, or whatever you would call what you do, is giving me the power, not that I have to rely upon you, like
That's
AA.
It.
I love that. That's the thing that I appreciate about your program. It's going to give it to me, and I feel like I have that.
You do. You know what? It takes one to know one. Now, I don't have any credentials. I don't want any. My credentials you see shining in me. That's it. No more than that. And it's that in me that is possible, if it's in me, to awaken you to it. And sometimes just seeing, experiencing another human being who knows the light, who's sure of that light and has never doubted it, see, and confirms the fact that you have, that's your problem, come back to it. That moment is more than all the psychology, all the religion. It brings you back to a nature. See? Now, have you ever, in the Bible, it's the scribe, not the scribes, but the disciples will go around saying, in the name of Jesus, do this. Really, to be more accurately, what they were really saying, in a sense, in the nature of Jesus, by his nature, by his authority, not by only his name. See, can you imagine, just to illustrate it, can you imagine someone coming to your door at night a policeman wants to get in. He has a warrant to search your place. And he'll say, open up in the name of the law. And you look outside, you see if he's dressed in the right uniform. See if he has a badge, right? In the name of the law, right? But he has to be dressed in the right uniform. And of course, he could be a crook, but the point is, he's gonna hold up a badge and you may let him in, right? Okay, well, can you imagine him holding up a stick of salami and saying, in the name of salami, let me in? You can't see that, see? In other words, he has to have everything. He has to have the uniform, he has to have the badge, and he has the right name. It's the same thing. I want to get into you somehow. I want to reach you in some way. And unless I have all of the trappings, but especially the nature, see, because I want your nature to recognize my nature, and that is the catalyst. Because it immediately you recognize it and acknowledge it, and you're glad to see it, something is established in you that starts to grow. It's antithetical to when you saw the nature of your parents, the dark side, and you saw, and it made you doubt. It separated you from your bright side. It made you doubt, and it upset you, and it got into you. And that's all you've ever known. And it in you made your conscience your enemy. So that you began to have the same habits as the world, but even though you weren't as the world, not quite, something in you is still different. You know what I'm saying?
But also, I don't want to give up sex.
And I never said you should.
But I'm having a problem with that, like with the alcohol. I don't really indulge in alcohol that much, but there are times I'd like to have
a drink.
It's okay,
have a glass of wine with your dinner. That way you know that you are you have the moderating spirit. A person who does not have the moderating spirit cannot do anything with propriety. If he eats, he's going to eat too much. If he drinks, he's going to drink too much. If you have sex, he's going to get into it until he can't get out of it anymore. Is that right? And the more he does it, the more he wants it. And the more he wants it, the more guilty he is. The more guilty he is, the more he needs sex not to feel guilty.
But some of us,
which is the very thing that makes him guilty.
All it takes is once to have sex and we're hooked. You know?
Yes, right, you are.
I had a good point this morning. You're talking about schools and about the drug problems, and he said, if someone were to put something in your drink without realizing it,
right,
that it really wouldn't affect you, or it wouldn't affect somebody who has a conscience or a control over themselves in a disciplinary way.
Okay.
But where with somebody else who's weaker, that substance fills all the void loopholes in there.
It's an offering. If somebody puts something in your drink and that produces a certain effect, like a feeling of euphoria, the weak person would immediately seize upon that to draw some value from it that should not be there.
Right, because they have like loopholes. I look at the water coming over and filling up all the loopholes in there.
It's not quite like that. It is well documented that some people get into drugs for a while, but they never get addicted. They cannot be addicted because they are more of where I'm coming from. See, they are more. They try it, and yet somehow it doesn't do anything, because there's got to be something in your soul that is set up to become compatible with it. By hook or by crook, by design, or, you know, you going to say something?
I was just going to say, my mother is a very energetic person, always very social, member of the junior league and this and that, and she's very positive, likes to party and that kind of atmosphere thing. I'm not, and in saying this, I'm not trying to challenge you. You know, I've followed you for 2 months now, and I think what you say is great, but some things puzzle me.
All right.
One of which is...
I just love challenges.
Well, one of which is, that joyful... I wonder if sometimes you're denouncing the joyful spirit to enjoy life, to go out and have a good time, because that's what I like to do.
Yeah,
you know.
That's what I was saying, too. I still want to enjoy those things, and with that same kind of rush and excitement that I had. You talking about emotions.
The sex, the denouncing the sex, the drinking.
I'm not denouncing any of it.
I guess that's what I'm asking.
Did you hear me say a person who is moderate, who is together, is temperate. He always knows when it's enough. He cannot go the extra mile or whatever it is.
Okay.
See, he can't do that. In other words, you take a lot of people going to a party and they get such a rush, they become addicted to partying. See? And you become addicted to drinking in the party. And then that awakens all kinds of sexual desires, and pretty soon you've got promiscuous sexuality and all kinds of problems mixing with the wrong people because you've lost your discretion. You lost a modifying spirit.
Yeah.
See?
This is, I don't know, almost embarrassing.
Go ahead.
Sorry. This is almost embarrassing. I'd go to, I was getting so, as I said earlier, looking forward to racing home to see your show, and you know, I was starting to, inside, and as you say, as opposed to the outward world, interacting with the outward world, my inner self was starting to grow, that growth.
You like
good
that?
Feeling, yeah, loved it, you know, as you say, that moment that
it's
you
a good
realize
not,
the
it's
truth.
It's a good not feeling, it's a good not feeling.
Oh, it's fantastic, but then...
You understand how I said it?
I was starting to go to work, and I'd just be sitting there, you know, interacting, feeling good about everybody else, you know, and I wasn't getting anything done.
Yeah, get back. See? Well, you've got to be careful of not...
What do you have to say? I'm talking... How can you use this to be productive?
Did you know?
I mean, I'm not saying I'm lazy or a bum or any of that.
Well, I think you're not handling this new knowledge properly yet. Because one of the big problems of experiencing Roy Masters is to become very hyper and flushed with excitement. And wow, this is it, man. See? And to get all kinds of excitement and to want to reach into my books and cassettes. But you see, all you're doing is substituting one culture for another. I become your culture. And you'd become a little wind-up robot. and it will become so perfectly transferred to me that you will not have noticed the difference because your caught-upness will have precluded the ability to observe it.
But are you denouncing?
Do you know what I'm? Did I say it right?
Yeah.
I don't want you. Listen. You know what I love about life?
Are you denouncing going out and having a good time and
I'm not
enjoying life?
If you would come to my house, I swear I'm gonna put one of those special microphones in my house, and when my kids come in, because they're 35 to 23, and with all the kids, and just see. It looks like Popeye's Mansion. The walls keep, you know, there's so much fun, but nobody drinks and nobody smokes and no one listens to music, no one parties. They have so many jokes that Bob Hope, God bless him, could get a lot of new lines from that. I mean, they come out so spontaneous. It's one barrel of laughs, my home. And when the kids come in, it is one big party. So I'm saying there is a way of being high, there is a way of being happy, but it is something not dependent upon the rush that you get from the world that you live in. See? It's an inner something, and it's a sweet and innocent joy, and you can never be intoxicated with it. You can never have too much with it. It's always the right amount because it's the right relationship, you see? You cannot be overbalanced with it. It's always perfect.
I like that.
You like that? Yes.
It's like I can hear something being said, like I just like to put it in another way. You're talking about how the spirit of moderation, that's like you remain accountable to your conscience. And you're saying when you take things to the excess, you're talking about like part of the excitement and like going beyond moderation, isn't it like you're looking for the value of being released from your conscience?
That's
and that's
all
where
it
the
is.
Line is.
Going beyond moderation
it's
has always
you're looking
to do
for that release. It's like you want to lose.
It's
your conscience.
It is absolutely right. Going beyond moderation, it's in his words, and playing it back, is always one has one motive behind it, is to be released from the inhibition of conscience, not only to do what's wrong, because the wrong in you flourish. The error inside you grows from an emotional connection. You understand? The self within the self that's real is connected to the truth, whatever that means. A flow of life, an inbreathing from within you that very few people know. They only know it as conscience or conflict, being in conflict. So that part of us that's in conflict, in order to exist, has to be connected and constantly reconnected. So its nature can be reinforced through a rush of excitement. So two things happen at one time. One, you get caught up with the excitement, conscience disappears. Release, immediate release, emotion. You get caught up, and you get caught into it, but what is you into gets into you, and you feel like you're more of a person. But you're more of a person for which reason you have conscience. Now, this is the nature of addiction, that in order to release the conflict between having become worse for rejecting reality, see how I said that? Let me say it again. You get caught up with a rush. The rush, you get caught up in that rush, and you get caught away from the reality, which is conscience. That's release. Release from guilt. Release from boredom. Release from discovering how wrong and dead you are. See? From seeing the mess that you've made of your life. All that reality is gone. For a second, you get caught up into that, and it comes into you, and more of what you think of as you is there, but that's the sin self. That is more of a sin self that is now in greater conflict with conscience, which now needs greater amounts of rush. Drugs, sex, you have to have more, you have to get deeper into it to get away from reality in order to be. Otherwise you'll disintegrate. You cannot sit still in a room.
What is there that's so contagious about a laugh or people at a party having a good time?
It's reinforcement. It's the dirty jokes, the sexual connotations, the presence of other people, degenerates just like yourself. It is such a jolly feat because everybody has to drink. They got to get into that. See, they got to... Well, hold a second. We got to save this tomorrow. Tomorrow is really, you know, more of tonight for us. So we are... I hate lies. See? I don't know. This is a program without any pitches. You know, Jim and Tammy... Talk. And we, you know, you can't join, you can't belong. We are a church. We depend upon donations. Nobody has their hat out when they come through the door. You know, it costs money to produce the show. And I just feel like making a presentation like this off the cuff, having fun together. See how we're laughing right now? You're talking about the good. If we sat together long enough without the lights and the television cameras glaring, we could have fun like a barrel of monkeys, and there wouldn't be any drink, there wouldn't be any drugs. It would just have fun being with one another and bringing each other to the best rather than, is that right? That's what's in my home. See, pure happiness in not needing anything to make you happy. Freedom, isn't that right? The meditation, please, write to us for it. It will teach you how to be, to find this life and energy from within yourself and be independently happy. Not dependently happy. What kind of happiness is that? Tomorrow, thank you very much. Join us in the next program.
Part 3 is next.
The foundation of human understanding teaches an observation exercise, often called meditation, which permits you to become objective toward your problems and allows your heartaches, bad habits, fears, and anxieties to be completely eliminated from your life without effort on your part. Until you have begun to practice this exercise, much of what you see and hear on the following program may be shocking and upsetting to you. But if you will listen calmly and with an open mind, you may discover the key to the peace of mind and joy for which you've been searching all of your life. And now, from the foundation of human understanding, here is Roy Masters.
We're trying to understand our mind. As a matter of fact, if you try to understand it, you'll never understand it. There's got to be a way of looking at your thoughts without analyzing them. If you could do that, you'll understand yourself. Understanding is a great mystery, and to that end, this program is dedicated to bring you to understanding. To talk about things which run parallel to what you've been looking for, all of a sudden you pick up on something in such a special way that you'll remember what you've forgotten. All knowledge, really, is something you already know. And you've just forgotten it. Especially the knowledge concerning ethics and morality and principles by which your inner person is guided and shaped. But a usurper has crept its way into our midst and tries to displace this wonderful, joyous journey of becoming who we were designed to be, and takes great pleasure into tearing down this self and establishing another one with different sets of pleasures and joys and happiness is. See? And I can just have fun with you sitting here. We could, without these lights, of course, and everything would be a lot more fun. We can go on for hours and hours, as we do in Tall Timber Ranch in Oregon when I have my seminar, 6 hours a day. It is amazing how fun it is to be with strangers, people you never met before, and to sit, talk about their problems, laugh, joke, cry. And 6 hours goes by and you don't even notice it. It just, we pointed out, hey, we've been sitting here for 6 hours talking about life and having fun. Nobody drank, nobody smoked, nobody wanted to. It's so much joy in discovering one another. How much joy do I have when I can watch my three-year-old, two-year-old child, I can watch that little kid all day long, just watching. There's such joy in me. And the little child, little baby, also has joy in being watched. There's communication. Me, the watcher, the child being watched, getting that kind of attention. Doesn't have to nag me for that attention. Because then if I give it attention by nagging, it's the attention she's got by contrivance, by manipulation, and it becomes the wrong kind of attention. And it feeds the wrong self, the manipulated self. See, now, we're talking about the mind, and we were talking in our last segment about happiness. And we're trying to define what it is, I think. That's what we were getting to, weren't we? What happiness is really is. Now, the last thing I said was, happiness is not needing anything to make you happy. But that's my job. I want you to be so free that you don't need anything to make you happy, that you are always happy, and that nothing can make you unhappy. Because it is the greatest delight of some people. Their greatest happiness is to make you unhappy, to take your happiness away, because they think they have happiness, because they can't see the truth. The egotistical happiness is thumbing its nose at reality, see? So if it doesn't know it's unhappy, it's happy. It sort of gets away with something it shouldn't. But if you're happy and you know what happiness is, and because you're innocent and you have the innocent joys that is peculiar to innocent people, nobody else understands it, see? And other people see that you see, and you see that they're not happy, they see that they're not happy, and it gives them great pain for you to see them as they are. And it reminds them of reality, which they don't want to face. They have not faced it as a means of being happy, drinking, smoking, partying, and all that thing. So they try to take your happiness away. They call you a party pooper or something weird, something wrong with you, man. You don't like dope, sex, music, pot. You know, you don't like to do, what you're living for, they say. What's your life for? And I don't see that's living. My view is completely opposite. I can understand them, but they can't understand me. I have two points of view, they only have one. And they're threatened by my one. So they try to take my happiness away, because that's what makes them happy. Because as long as I'm looking at them as though they're crazy, as long as my reality shines so strong as undisturbed, it disturbs them. It makes them miserable. So they get relief by putting me out, putting my lights out. Now some people will make you happy in the same party by making you happy. But what does that mean? It means to help you put your conscience out. Here, guy, have a joint. You know, have another drink. Do you good. Let's drink to this person, or Marilyn Monroe, or Tammy Baker. See, I'll drink to that. See, they have a way of, you know, hyping, providing you with the electricity you need not to know that you're unhappy, and they have a way of loving you, stimulating you, sustaining you, supporting you in those needs that all egos have, mutually share, which is happiness, which comes from not knowing they're unhappy. See? Now, I am a happy person. And it's, I'm not saying it's impossible. I mean, sure, there are some things that could take my happiness away, you know. But generally speaking, in the ordinary course of life, I'm quite stout in my resistance to those forces that try to take my happiness away. I'm hep to what people... hep to what... Using street language here. To what everybody's up to, see? And I make a lot of people unhappy. I make a lot of people angry. You should be at the radio station when I finish my program. I mean, it looks like a beehive, you know? Like someone upset a hornet's nest. Get that guy off the air. He's the devil, especially Christian fundamentalists. They think I'm crazy because I don't mention Jesus every 2 seconds. I talk about the things in a common sense way, in a simple way, a way that enlightens and gives true joy, but not in the way that they do, where you boogie-woogie down the aisle. And you get another kind of religiousizing. See what I mean? I give you a religious experience, and they give you religious excitement. And the religious excitement is all ego support. Nobody has to face themselves when you can religiousize yourself with good behavior to counter-program the otherwise bad behavior. They become addicted to being religiousized into good behavior, but you're still a wind-up toy. It isn't coming from within you, and you can never really be happy. Some people, that they spend their whole lives in alcohol or religiousizing, where they think they are something, and the alcoholic thinks he's okay, because he can't see that he isn't. And the religiousizer thinks he's a good Christian, going to heaven when he's one going to hell, right? And he's perfectly happy with that, but some of you are not. Is that all right? You're not happy with it because there's something still alive in you, isn't there? Right? Yes.
I wanted you to clarify something we discussed in the last segment. I think the gentleman brought it up about alcoholism. And I don't understand. Are you saying that if a person has had a problem with alcohol or drugs, any of these addictive type things, and then they become a part of these different groups or they stop, are you saying that once they start meditating that they can again go back and pick up these vices successfully? Because I don't believe you can. I don't believe that's possible.
No, what I was saying is that if you get caught up with Roy Masters, being excited with my meditation, be excited by getting a little energy, a rush from my radio program or TV program. See, it's very easy to transfer your addiction from culture to me, and I become a culture or counterculture, mm-hmm. a culture within a culture. See, and I don't want that to happen. Because I'm trying to get you to quietly enjoy. To quietly enjoy what I'm saying. There's a little joy inside, but you can't let it spill over and become the usual kind of emotional thing that one experiences when one enjoys something in a sensual way. Do you follow what I'm saying?
Yes, but I don't think you know what I mean. What I'm saying is that because you have stopped drinking,
yes,
and you become aware, you know, become involved in, you know, the meditation and those other principles, that has to be incorporated along with the not drinking. I don't think that can replace the fact that you cannot drink. I think if you can't drink, you can't drink. I don't care how much you meditate. Once you have become an addictive personality to that substance, I don't see you successfully, because you can meditate saying, oh, well, I was a person who used to drink every day, get drunk or whatever. Now I'm meditating, I can have a glass of beer, one glass of beer, and I won't go back to the addictive behavior, you know, being That's caught up with the alcohol. What you're saying?
I'm saying this, that once a person becomes infilled with that right identity spirit, mm-hmm. that the mark of that, the evidence of it, is that if he was an alcoholic, mm-hmm. and he couldn't touch a glass of wine without flipping completely out and not knowing where he is, you know, 3 days later, mm-hmm. he can drink that glass of wine, and the evidence that he's found the moderating spirit, mm-hmm. and he can drink that glass of wine without it wanting any more out of than what's in it. One, there's something about the addictive personality which is a compulsive denier of reality. And the wine or the whiskey or the spirit or whatever it is, the particular form of excitement, intoxication, is simply the means by which, if a person stops smoking, he'll stop drinking. If he stops did you see that the addictive personality is a person who cannot face reality, that wants to preserve his ego life. Jesus said it rather well. He says, "Whosoever shall preserve his life shall lose his life. Whoever shall lose his life shall find the life." Or she's really, the word is "for my sake, whoever shall lose himself for my sake." But in the proper translation of that, it will read more accurately, "Whosoever shall lay down or preserve his ego, animal, life and breath, shall lose the spiritual." There are two words for life in Greek. That's souche and zoe. Souche is the animal life and breath. Who shall ever lay down that which gives life to the animal? The ego animal, that's what we are, right? In modern terms. If you keep reinforcing your ego life, you're denying the real life. And that's exactly what you are. Mm-hmm. See, because the real life is in conflict with your earth life. The self, the life that comes from the sin, see? It reinforces that. It helps you not know that it is sin. And it helps, but that's sin itself. What helps you to not know it's sin is more sin, isn't it? Which requires you, since you become more of a sinner, to have more stimulation, more intoxication, not to know it, you see? So the evidence that a person, for instance, with a glass of wine, you could do it because it is a drink. And even Jesus drank like wine, and he was in the wine-making business, I understand, for a little while. Wasn't he? Didn't he turn water into wine? Mm-hmm. We all turn wine into water, I know. We don't have those powers, you see. But the point is, he's in the business for a while, so. But you can't go back to being a whore. Mm-hmm. See, you can't, there's certain things you can't do. A certain thing, drinking a glass of wine is perfectly normal, although I never drink. I may take a sip out of my wife's glass once in a while, but there's nothing there for me at all. I don't even like the taste of the stuff. So, I'm not above drinking a glass of wine if I'm in a lady's home and says we'd like something, and yeah, okay, you know, no big deal. I don't get anything out of it at all. Nor do I. The spirit in me is so happy, it doesn't need that happiness spoiled. It doesn't need it enhanced because it would spoil it. Do you follow that? So I say yes, the sign of a person who has this new self within the self, that's from within, inbreathed, who's laying down his earth self, the given earth self, is a person who is moderate in all his ways. See? He that striveth for the mastery, says Paul, is temperate.
But you program yourself when you do that, because just like you were saying about a cigarette, the first cigarette, you have to fight to get to enjoy it. But once you get beyond that point that you can take, that you can inhale, and you stop coughing, you have programmed the brain.
Oh, well, you
this
know,
is pleasure.
What I'm saying
so
is,
you will continue, even if you stop smoking. I stopped smoking what a I number
say,
of years ago.
For instance, let's say you stop smoking. Yeah. You wouldn't be silly enough to start inhaling it again. You just, because your sense would govern you, wouldn't it? But let's say someone forced you to inhale it, put a gun to your head or something. Mm-hmm. It's not going to make you into a cigarette addict anymore. It's not. You wouldn't resent being forced. But some people put a gun to his head, smoke that cigarette, or else I'll blow. Okay. You get so unnerved, so upset, that after the incident is gone, you become addicted to cigarettes again because you didn't handle the situation properly. Oh, there comes the need for the cigarettes to help you to soothe that pain of reality. There's a young lady, she's right over there. She had a gun to her head. She's working in a store. She's the camera lady over there. See ya? And I'd hope this doesn't go to her head, because it could, but two people in the store, a young man and herself, and the gunman came in, put a gun to their head, and demanded whatever. And when the gunman went away, the guy's still, you know, he's in therapy. He'd probably be in therapy for the rest of his life, and they're not going to cure him. She went home, went to sleep, and forgot all about it. Two different kinds of people. You deal with a reality situation in a right way. If you're God-centered, if you are made of that which does not respond, is not an opportunist, because even responding to a gunman is still one of those opportunities for excitement you cannot resist. It's new trauma. It's new experience. It's more of a new self. It can't resist it. You understand that? It will get overexcited. Everything overexcites it. Everything overstimulates it. And then some people will say, some of those people who are artsy, who are so tuned in, electrically tuned into the world, where they're so caught up in all the cultural things, and they're dear and darling, you know, you know what I'm kind of talking about? Those are the ones who say, well, I'm so sensitive, dear. Oh, you're so sensitive. As if that was a compliment. See? They're imbibing all the... They've found a way to lock into all the pretty things, the statues, the art, and all the hypocrisies and the silly symphonies of life. And to clothe themselves, to hide their insanity, their beast, in this trivia. See? As if it was culture, as if it was something. They know the name of Beethoven and Bach, and they know all the various names of the wines and what you have with dinner, and they're caught up in that as if it was some kind of knowing, it's some kind of sophistication. Totally insane. They're caught up. That's still a form of excitement. They're extremely sensitive to the environment, and every person who is wrong is sensitive to the environment. See? They can't help themselves. Yes.
I'm having a problem, and I've enjoyed your show last night so much I came back tonight.
Yeah, well, you mean you haven't moved?
I'm trying to arrive for you here.
You're going to go back to drinking for that.
Yeah. After tonight, I might, right? I have two younger children, and right. I watch my two-year-old and the excitement that he sees life with, and how he's eager to get out there and experience life. And that's what I'm talking about. I see an attractive woman, and I don't want
not
moderation. I like that excitement.
Too bad for you. Suffer.
You don't think that's good?
No, I don't.
Really?
But you have to learn through pain and suffering about that condition. Because slowly, the attractive woman, I mean, if a little bit of excitement is good, a lot of excitement's better.
Yeah.
And as you keep responding to what you think is better more and more excitedly, slowly you lose control over your life. You're losing control. If I make you upset right now, who's in control, me or you? Is it good to be upset, you think?
Oh, no.
No, because if you get upset, that means you lose control. I gain it. If I was a pretty woman, I could excite you just by wiggling my fanny.
Sure.
And if I could excite you, and you become, and you feed yourself, you feed something in you as a result of that, then what is in you is growing in conflict with what should grow, and now become dependent upon my wiggling form. So that you get more and more into me, but I'm getting into you. And me is who you are. And when you see that me is who you are, you can't stand it. But how do you deal with it? You get into me more. And pretty soon the woman, you're giving power to the witch. The woman becomes more and more of a witch, and you become more and more subject to the witch, and pretty soon you begin to feel trapped, don't you?
But does it have to be one or the other?
Well, you see, just like a little child, the Bible says something very beautiful. I love the Bible, by the way, but I don't quote it very often, you see, because I am the Bible. I'm the Bible answer man. Except I don't need a Bible. It's written in my soul, you see what I mean? The Bible says man is born first of nature, then of spirit. It used to be the other way around. Adam was a fallen being. He has a living soul. And when he fell from the nature of God, then he fell to the nature of nature and the spirit of that nature, which is the woman, right? And ever since that time, instead of man being born of God and woman coming out of man, it's been reverse. You know, man is remade over in the image of woman, and he goes into woman and man comes out of woman. See? And so that children come into the world the way, not the way God created Adam, but after the fall, man came out of woman, not woman came out of man. You understand that? Now, this is peculiar to man alone, because all the animals of the world have not this peculiarity, because they have no spiritual origin. Man is of nature unnaturally natural. Animals are naturally natural, follow me. And man is unnaturally natural. He's in conflict with his nature. And anything that reinforces that nature, see, the ego nature, enforces the conflict with God and makes it impossible to develop the inner man that can enter the kingdom. Say, flesh and blood, that type of sensuality cannot enter the kingdom. But slow. So little children, when you come, they come out of the womb, they come into the world, there's a certain amount of excitement and sibling rivalry and anger and a frustration and bickering, but they have to grow in the natural way. And I'll tell you this, you have to grow in your natural way, fighting, arguing, fussing, being hurt, getting upset, interacting with things, feeling nature, enjoying fishing, getting into the fishing getting into you, you being addicted to this, music, whatever it is. This is part of how you, if you weren't an earth person, the first of nature, you wouldn't be any, you have to grow as an ego person. Otherwise you couldn't grow, you have to go grow wrong before you can grow right. There's got to be something there to change. You understand that? Because man is, his origin is original sin. Therefore, what grows first is of nature and of pride. And then we reach the threshold of nature and pride, all of a sudden, what we enjoyed as excitement and stimulation a few minutes before, which was appropriate. See, getting into fishing, getting into baseball, getting all the excitement. When we have reached the zenith of that particular kind of evolution to the point where Adam stood, you see, where he fell as a changed man with conflict, we reach this threshold of conscience. And the moment, the second we reach the threshold of conscience, the very things we enjoy, like baseball and hot dogs and souped up sex and all the kind of things that super stimulating, all things that we think of the gusto of living, the partying, all the things we thought that really made life worth living and was what we call fun, suddenly stopped being fun. Who knows what I'm talking about? And it wasn't Freud, it was Jung, who was the Christian type psychologist. He said, men's ego, I can't remember his exact words, forgive me, because I'm not good at that sort of thing, but men's, the trouble with egos, the modern man, is that he's afraid to grow up to face reality, and he goes back into his subconscious and like a child in his imaginings. So it's like a second fall. We all get to that threshold of reality where we see there's something wrong with the way we exist and all the pleasures and all the excitements and all the fun that we thought were fun. At that point, don't seem to have the fun that they used to have. Now the problem is, the big danger here is to try to make them more fun. Who understands what I'm saying? And the more you try to make them more fun, to feed the ego, the more, now you're starting a second fall, and now you're doing business with the devil. It's a second fall is what it is. But this time you're doing it now deliberately. You didn't inherit the condition. You're doing it with malice. Something's wrong, and now you continue denying that it is wrong. Now, you never were born right. So you don't have such a thing as an original wrong. You inherit that. And see, and all the pleasures and funs you've had has brought you to the realization, here I am a human form. I am a being. I'm from the earth. But suddenly, something tells you that you don't exist in a proper way. Where before, seconds before, you thought you did. See, you may have a sneaking suspicion that something was wrong, but at a very special point in time and space, there it is. You can't have the fun anymore, and you think there's something wrong with you. And other people look at you, they sense that you're seeing, you're sort of questioning. They immediately become a threat. Who knows what I'm talking about? You do that. Am I making a point? You are a young man, so how old are you?
41.
Well, you're getting to the point now, soon, where you're going to start experiencing this, and possibly you had a history of alcoholism. Mm-hmm. See, so you no doubt had a taste of that because you got a conscience for experiencing life too much. Not laying down your life, but picking it up.
I like the experiencing, I don't like the hangovers.
Exactly. Is that perfectly said? He loves the experience, but doesn't like the guilt.
Yeah. But I'm trying to get to a point where I can still partake without it giving me that hangover. And not moderation. Moderation to me is like being locked into the porcelain bathroom.
I know that, but there is a way of moderating without being confined to a porcelain bathroom, as you say.
That's what I want to find.
And it must be voluntary, and it's a gradual process of realizing. You're going to have to make a few mistakes, not only a few, well, quite a few, and you're going to keep experimenting with those same mistakes, the more sex, this or that, which you kind of like too much, until you discover that you can't enjoy it, and that there's got to be, it creates more trouble than it's worth.
I think it's interesting that you've got to ask yourself why.
What? Can you hold that?
Yeah.
We went through another half hour, believe it or not. It didn't feel like a half hour.
We'll come back tomorrow.
Come back tomorrow night, but don't go away.
We call it tomorrow, right?
Okay. Stand there till tomorrow night.
Yeah, I'll stay right.
Thank you very much. Ladies and gentlemen, please keep our program on the air. I mean, don't let this fall on deaf ears. We can't make it otherwise. It's terribly expensive. And I just, frankly, don't have the money unless you send it in. So support the program if you find this program valuable, hearing. You know, you're never going to hear this anywhere else on radio or television. Thanks for listening, and join us again.
Part 4 is next.
Hello. We're talking about the mind and its peculiar relationship with its environment. And we were talking about what happiness is and what fun is and what real growth is and maturity. And I've said that we're first born of nature and then of spirit, and that we naturally are tuned, connected to the environment, and we draw from it, as animals do, something of ourselves, draw up into ourselves something that we think of as us, and that at a certain point in our life, in our adventuring and our excitement, our loves and our hates and our pleasures and drinking and partying, whatever it is, that self that evolves comes in conflict with what ought to be. And at a certain point in our evolution, so somewhere around 18, 19, 20, we start to be vaguely aware that something's wrong with the way we exist. And that's when we have problem with pleasure, with excitement. We're about to discover at a certain point in our maturity that there's another dimension that we have to enter, that we have to transcend the life that we, our cultural existence. Cannibals have to outgrow being cannibals and become something else. Iranians have to outgrow Ayatollah, see? And Jewish people have to outgrow Moses, see? Where did Moses get his identity, his understanding, after, you know, his knowledge that he shares with us? See? I mean, he didn't have anybody to teach him. Jesus didn't have anybody to teach him. He was an enlightened person and sets the parameters or the example that we must follow. And it's this problem that we have with our lives, especially in America. We have so much pleasure, so much excitement, so much music. You know, we can literally have a rose stuffed in our nose all the time. Like we have music stuffed in our ear. If you saw a person walking around sniffing a rose all the time, you know there's something wrong with that guy. But you get music everywhere, in elevators and in stores, constantly around, surrounded by excitement and distraction and stimulation and pretty women and postcards and bright lights and music and buying new cars, friendships and partying, sex, you name it. We are totally immersed in this, and it's breeding in us a strange dissatisfaction with the material things, because there's only material things in the world we live in has only so much ability to provide for growth, and there's a certain value to enjoying this and enjoying that and living it up and being a kid running free and in the fields and in the woods and doing some of the silly things you do, partying and smoking a joint and whatever it is you do, sexing. But then there comes a point where the self that that which is born of nature, which is now ready to be born of spirit, comes into conflict with that which is ready to be born into, the life it's ready to be born into. And that's the problem. The whole world militates against that. All right, am I making sense to you, ladies and gentlemen? And so this is what we're talking about this evening, right? Okay?
I want to know, I've followed you since Western Avenue, and I raised my children, and I don't say that I went away from you, because what I learned helped me raise my children. But I'm at a point now where the children are grown, and I have this obsession. I work in a drug center, where it seems like to me I just want to help young people. It's like a, you know, an aching. I walk down the street and I see it. Somebody is coming short, and I've mainly blamed it on churches and people. God forgive me. But I feel if you live it, you don't have to say so much. But then it's a thing with me that I don't want to come short in young people looking at me, watching me, feeling me, and seeing what I am. And I presented this to a minister, which I felt was on the same basis as I was. I presented this teaching to him, which he picked up without no records, no meditation.
He picked up where you were coming from.
And I would like to know if this obsession of this love of young people.
Well, let's be careful of this obsession, because it could be an ambition. It could be a form of righteousness, self-righteousness. It could be a form of mothering that you don't know how to give up. You've mothered your children, and maybe you did a good job, maybe you didn't. If you've mothered them too much, you haven't done such a good job as you think you have, but you don't know how to stop getting the benefits, this ego satisfaction of spoiling and mothering and catering.
Even so for the down and outers.
You've got to be very, yes. I'm sorry to say that I like to help young people. I like to help every person. I'm telling you, I know from personal experience that I don't have a feeling of love towards anybody. Now that sounds really gross. See, and I didn't have to say it. Now everybody's going to shut off their TV and this guy's crazy. I am not the source of love for anyone. I know my limitations. I am Roy Masters, clay. See, my feet are clay and my brain is clay. And I'm nothing. I know that I'm nothing, not capable of originating, not even my own thoughts. See, I know that. That's very humbling, but that doesn't make me feel humble. It is kind of sobering. I know nothing, but yet I know. If I think I know something, then I know nothing, because in my knowing something, I'm caught up in a lie. And I only think I know because I think. Yeah, well, hold the line a second. You hold it there, because I'm making a point, if you don't mind. I'll be right with you. So it's this, if I feel, let me just go over a little more ground. If I feel brave, I am not brave. If I feel happy, I am not happy. If I feel good about myself, I'm no damn good. I'm caught up in a lie. Mm-hmm. Hold up your finger, and it doesn't feel like anything, does it? That's a good finger. It doesn't feel a thing. Now, if I burn that finger and then put it into cold water, it feels good. Now I know if I've got any brains, I know my finger is burned and there's something wrong with it. Otherwise, it wouldn't feel good. The best feeling I can have about that finger is to have no feeling at all. The best feeling you can have about yourself is not to have a feeling about yourself. Not feeling sorry for other people, because that's only elevating mm-hmm. yourself. Mm-hmm. Your low self feels high mm-hmm. and suddenly lifted. You don't have any shoes and suddenly you feel terrible and dejected and depressed because you have no shoes. And now you meet a man without any feet and suddenly you feel better. See? Well, that's terrible. to feel better because you see somebody hasn't got any feet, you see. Mm-hmm. So if I am a good person, I don't need to feel good. If I'm 10 feet tall, I don't need to feel 10 feet tall because I am 10 feet tall, and that's all there is to it. And I don't aspire to be 20 feet tall. I don't even notice I'm 10 feet tall. But if I am standing, if you're standing next to me and I'm 10 feet tall and you're 2 feet tall, you feel diminished by that, then the only way you could feel 10 feet, you start to aspire to something, you should be really happy with what you are. But you're not. That's pride. So now in order to feel like 10 feet, you got to be, in order to be 10 feet tall, the only way that can be accomplished is to feel like you were when you're not. And now, feeling good and feeling fine and doing all the things that make you feel, even feeling sorry for someone, you can become addicted to helping yourself to feelings of importance by helping the poor and the homeless. And you see, but those kinds of people who are addicted to becoming nurses and old age care people and going down into the inner cities and giving out bread, they never help anybody. They never help a living soul. I tell you that the beggar that comes up to you in the street, how does he stay a beggar? Because he knows how to make you feel sorry for him. We won't go into the methods, because I could tell you what the method is. That's another 10 minutes or 15 minutes. But the method is to give you, your low self, a feeling of importance by giving them 25 cents. You feel so important, you feel so big. But he has made you feel something. And now, but he has become dependent. He doesn't have to become a better person, because he can make you feel sorry for him, and he can get without working, without actually being. And he can get away with the feeling he's fooled you. He feels like he can make anybody serve his ego need. See that? He stays a beggar. And the more you help people like that, the more they stay beggars. And the more you feel guilty about that, and because there is a guilt involved for feeling something you're not, because it's actually a substitute for salvation. Anything that makes you feel good, even if it's giving a quarter to a beggar.
They're even resentful towards you.
They can be resentful towards you because somehow you've
supplied their...
That's right. Somehow, deep down inside, they wish they would say, hey, knock it off. I know your game.
Is this the reason... For the reasons that you presented to me that I accept, that is not the reason why I presented it to a minister.
Look, I don't know about your relationship with the gentleman minister. All I know is the question.
Any minister.
It doesn't matter who they are. All I can address myself is to the question you've posed me. That Roy Masters has an impersonal feeling with that person. If you come up to me and you ask me for a loaf of bread, I am not going to feel anything. Because the minute I start to feel something, I am in an ego involvement. I'm being manipulated. I'm being controlled. I'm getting something out of that relationship that is not proper to have. If I get something out of it, I like myself. And now I become addicted. But I also become an easier victim the next time. And pretty soon I'm giving the shirt off my back and wondering why everybody's taking advantage of me and no one's getting any better. See? Then I'm upset because of that, and then I feel even more guilty, and I think the reason why I'm guilty, I'm not giving enough. Because now you're into the giving thing as a means of feeling good. You're addicted just like an alcoholic. You're addicted to giving the shirt off your back for good feelings about yourself. You die a martyr. You feel used and downtrodden, and you think you're good and everybody's so bad. See, and you've ruined the world and ruined yourself because you didn't have godly compassion. You're too into feelings. Yes, where'd I hear Roy
from? Over here. I was just wondering if you, because I know somewhere in the New Testament it talks about giving to those who beg. And
right.
It seems to me that what you're saying is that you give, but you give without feeling.
Should be no feeling in it. Does the person does look? If you give to get a feeling, the person who's getting it from you senses that you're taking a certain amount of pride. He hates you for that. You want me to be sorry for you? How would you feel like if I was sorry for you? Wouldn't you hate me for getting a feeling out of feeling important because you're not important? Wouldn't you hate me for that? Did you want people to be sorry for you? Don't you see the pride that swells up as a result of that? Does it do you any good for people to be? Is there any real love in that? I think not. There's only a reason for you to resent at the worst and to become dependent for the handout. So it's a debilitating dependency on. You see, it becomes a debilitating dependency like welfare.
Mm-hmm.
So I have never given my children anything. And they're all doing very well. By giving them nothing, or pretty close to nothing, I remember giving my son a quarter and then said if he could double that, I'd double it. So he did. I think how he did it, one of those ways he did it was Christmas and Halloween, and they went Halloween trick and treating, and they bought a whole bunch of candy. Instead of eating them, they sold them when all the kids' supplies ran out. And they made money. Then I doubled it. So someone had 10, 12 bucks. So I added 10 to that as an encouragement. And from that point onwards, I never gave them another nickel from that point to the rest, not even any pocket money. Because by not giving was my giving. I knew that if I loved my children, I could not rob them by giving them. I was talking to Ray here. Where are you, Ray, back there? I said, Ray, I'm not going to pay you any more than you're worth. Because if I did, you'd never grow. Do you know what's wrong with the society? The kids come out of school, and they come out of college, and they have this fat cat life. Their parents pay for their schooling. They get this pedigree, and then they go into $20 an hour, and they spend it on cocaine because they don't deserve it. They haven't understood. They haven't got down into the dirt. They haven't been stressed to bring the best out of them, because you've got to tap root into reality. And if you are spoiled and you're given too many things, you're robbed of your growing, the development of the self, reaching into yourself for answers. See? Because you've got too many things, it's too easy. See? It ruins you. So the best thing I can do is pay my employees very little. You know something? They appreciate it. As a matter of fact, you know something? I can't afford a whole lot, to tell you the truth, but the point is, I wouldn't pay them any more than they're worth because I love them. And you know something? They know it. Because the guys that work here now, they make $5 or $6 an hour, and they have saved more than when they earn more other places. And they are better people for it. And they know what to do with it. They know what the meaning of a buck is. See? They had to be wise with it. And they've discovered the sweetness of being wise. That with wisdom and self-denial becomes greater wisdom to deny self. But if you indulge self, then the reverse happens, don't you see? You indulge your children and you spoil them, they grow up to be big fat nothings. Look at your American children, overgrown twerps. Is that right? Overgrown nothings. Big fat little toads, spoiled little brats. They don't know how to produce, to create. The Vietnamese come over from wherever they come from, and they got their own businesses. Your kids are on welfare or dependent on the parents. They're freaking out. They make a decent living, but they're using it for dope because they have never grown. Do you know? Yes, I was going to take it further, but okay.
How the Vietnamese come over and they get their own businesses. In my experience, I see Americans, people who are native, and even my family, and I've seen just resentment toward, look at these people. They have their own business. They're just taking over. They in turn resent them, and then because of their independence and that
they're
strong.
That's exactly right. They resent them for their independence, yeah. And they are more truly American than the Americans themselves. Who've forgotten the whole idea of ethic and work and independence and not being involved with government handout and having someone be sorry for them. See, we have a whole class of people who are addicted to welfare, who have never lifted a finger. And they gripe, you know, we can't live on $20,000 a year. That's their complaint. We don't, you know, get all bent out of shape because they don't get the welfare checks. Something's wrong. Something's terribly wrong. And I'm going to tell you a little bit about this worth ethic. I don't know if I should follow it through all the way, but since I'm on it, there's two commandments given Adam. I love this fall of man thing, because I know man's a fallen being, and I know, because I can look at my own self, how my fallen self is in conflict with my self that could be. See what I mean? And I know all that is true. I don't remember having any original sin, but I grow up with a full awareness that there's something wrong with the way I exist, but I never made me that way. See? So where did that originate? And if I keep giving into that self, I become more in conflict with the self I could be. Follow that? But let me just give you the work ethic, and you can... The work ethic, the first commandment was not to reach for the fruit of knowledge. See, where you become your own God through... Not to become involved with knowledge, but to live by understanding, called faith, right? Adam became separate from the faith because, and life, the knowledge of God, which is understanding, which is not in books. It's native to you, like a dog knows how to be a dog and a canary knows how to be a canary. It's a native thing, see? It isn't learned. So now he's separated from that because of pride, and now he becomes a changed being, altered by the trauma of original sin, altered. He becomes earthy, sexual, his sensual nature, his death-centered nature awakened, and now the perpetuation of generation replaces the perpetuation of regeneration, you know what I mean? Still regenerating and living forever, the seed falls out of his body, as with woman too, and now they're replacing bodies because they're dying and falling away from reality and life. See? But the second commandment, the first commandment was pride. Don't eat of this knowledge because you can't be God, and don't even think of it because otherwise you're going to die. And we do die. We're born. To be born is to begin to die, and to discover death as part of life, which, and as a child, we know there's something wrong with that. We sense it, but everybody's dying around us, so we accept that as a normal. See? It isn't. But I won't go into that now. The second commandment was to work by the sweat of your brow. And if you do not, because there's something about working that's humbling. There's something about not working and getting a handout, having people be sorry for you and being on welfare. That's prideful. They're called welfare queens. They're not really queens, they're really degenerates, but these degenerates feel like queens, right, don't they? Because they're being served. Kings don't have to be, they get tribute. And therefore, the very act of not working and receiving money and support from someone without working supports the pride. And there's another thing that you've got to be very careful about working. You could be not working is one thing, but now working is another problem, because if you work to make something of yourself, to further the ends of your pride, that's another conflict. Goal setting, making a lot of money. Because what happens is that original sin is pride, and work is supposed to humble us. And if we work, we're actually doing the will of the Creator. And if we're doing the will of the Creator, that is the precondition for us, for wisdom, the light of God, to come into us and to guide us back to paradise. See? But if we're working pridefully or not working, it militates against that. Do you see that, what I'm saying? That's why they say idleness is the devil's playground. But so is work, for the wrong reasons, for distraction, become a workaholic, because there's escape and pride, a sense of becoming into your kingdom, becoming to buy a new car, a new... To have everybody look up, you say, look at me, everyone, look how successful. People look up to you like you were God. This, you fill yourself with pride. And these are the stimulations of environment which man, in order to come back to reality, must lay down. And your own experience testifies to this fact. Is that right? Your own experience tells you there's something wrong with not working and being dependent and being ruined and spoiled. And those who love you the most won't feel sorry for you. They'll let you struggle a little bit. Right, there's this young lady right here, because it was her turn next.
Yes, you mentioned that you have a sense of having fallen, though you can't remember actually falling.
Something wrong with my existence.
Right.
I knew that when I became conscious of my existence.
It seems to me that you're born with a certain knowledge, and because of stresses and stifling throughout the years and the culmination of these stifling factors that you lose this knowledge. And
you lose your way. You mean you lose that awareness that there's something wrong with you, with the way you exist, because there are so many forces in our environment that helps you lose it. Because if you hold on to the awareness that something wrong with the way you exist, you also see that something wrong with the way everybody else exists, and they don't like that, do they? See, you disturb the whole environment. And Roy Masters is a great iconoclast in the sense that I disturb an awful lot of people. A lot of people think I'm quite mad, see? But they thought Jesus was mad too, and they wanted to kill him.
My question is...
Hold it till tomorrow night.
Okay.
Could you hold it?
Sure.
I'm sorry, I rambled on there by myself, and forgive me, but I hope the point is made. Yes, New Dimension magazine, in this magazine, I have an article, I've written an article, The Coming Bloody Revolution in America. Why I think it can happen, and can it be prevented? Probably not. But I give you all the psychological, spiritual reasons, as I've given you this evening, it's inevitable. Okay? But you can be stopped, but I don't think it will be, see? And also, if you'll get at the magazine, you just call us during the daytime. In the evening, nobody's here. You know, I'm not saying this is the last magazine, hurry, you know. There's only a few of these left. We've got millions of them. You see, I don't want to use that on you. That's wrong motivation. Don't ever go for stuff like that. It destroys you if you reach for that. And the other book, the book is How Your Mind Can Keep You Well. And at the end of the program, which is in a few seconds, the announcer will give you where you can write for it. Please write for it. If you haven't got the money, we'll give it to you for no charge. We're going to pay these nincompoops to run the cameras and everything. And this nincompoop needs something too. So please, keep us on the air. Otherwise, it's just not possible. Just fade away. And you know, if you are coming from the same place as me, you know, perhaps you appreciate a program like this, which is rare as hen's teeth. Thank you for listening and watching, and join us again.
Part 5 is next.
The foundation of human understanding teaches an observation exercise, often called meditation, which permits you to become objective toward your problems and allows your heartaches, bad habits, fears, and anxieties to be completely eliminated from your life without effort on your part. Until you have begun to practice this exercise, much of what you see and hear on the following program may be shocking and upsetting to you. But if you will listen calmly and with an open mind, you may discover the key to the peace of mind and joy for which you've been searching all of your life. And now, from the foundation of human understanding, here is Roy Masters.
Remember, we're talking about how careful you got to give money and how important not to feel sorry for people. That's what Jim and Tammy Baker did. They made you feel. They made you feel good, didn't they? And you know, she's crying how much she loves God. So pretty soon you sympathize. You saw this woman crying, and she was so full of love. You empathized. You know, you felt what she felt, and you get caught up in this feeling which she was able to produce. You see someone cry, and they make you cry. You do tend to imitate what people. Monkey see, monkey do. It's, somebody gets mad at you, you get mad back. If somebody is nice to you, you're nice back. See? So therefore, you know, people, they project feelings, and therefore you get caught up in the feeling personality. This person is simply a scintillating mass of feeling. She's a feeling creator. And she makes you feel. And what the minute you start to feel, you start to get caught up with the feeling, and it's like a drug. You start to feel good, like you love God. You love God like she loves God. And you feel good and appreciative like she feels. She gives you those same feelings, but you're addicted. Now, in order to hold on to those feelings, you feel so good, you become indebted to the person that makes you feel. And so, therefore, you give money, especially if you're talking about God, because it's very glorifying. You give money to support the ministry. For them to be there every night to cry and have a a mascara run down her chest. And to see this, and to get caught up with it every night. And you wonder, how could these people ask for money and spend one long pitch for money, and yet those people there don't object to it. And they're not getting any better. They are addicted to her making those people feel. See, now, how many situations can you equate with that? How many situations, man-woman relationships especially, a woman makes a man feel, and that's how she makes him fall into feeling, into sensuality rather than sensibility. What does a woman really want for a man not to fall, not to be a source of feeling to him? You see that? That's what you want, not to be a source, to give him feeling, to sustain his ego through feeling. Because something wrong with that relationship. And I am sort of appealing to you, ladies and gentlemen, so that if you're going to support this program, it has to be because it's without feeling. Like you don't have a feeling when you write the light bill. Oh, I feel so good writing this light bill. Ooh, I could do. Right? I don't want that to happen. It has to be because it's right. And you know, don't let the children aggravate you into feeling guilty and then feeling sorry for them and to give to make up for feelings. See? And to make them happy. Because if they keep nagging you, they're going to make you unhappy. So you have to make them happy so they don't make you unhappy. See what I mean? See, so that you can't do that. You have to learn to become a person that is not person affected by nature, by the things around them, to be so centered that you see with great clarity things that really are. See, because it's feelings that cloud that. It gives you the illusion that you're generous when you're not, good when you're not. You ladies know that, don't you? Because you're great feeling creators. You make men feel, and it makes them feel, you get caught up with a feeling, and they'll give you everything. They'll worship you. The more you make them feel, the more you separate them from reality, and the more guilt they have, and the more guilt they have, the more they need you to make them feel. And your feelings, your relationship, a bond is established between the person who creates your feelings. And after a while, you find yourself trapped in it, having to give her more and more and more material things to hold on. And the more you give her, the less satisfied she is, because she's not happy with those material things either. What she wants is a man that doesn't need her for this sort of thing. Yes?
Boy, you're almost making it seem like scary to share.
Yes, I am. You've got to be very mature to listen to music. You've got to be very mature to eat a steak. You've got to be very mature to drink a glass of wine. You've got to be very mature to have sex. See, there's got to be something there's got to be some kind of guidelines, and you can't go wild. You can't go, yoo-hoo, here's sex. Yoo-hoo, into the glass of wine. See? Boy, I love those feelings. Let's have more and more and more and more. Pretty soon you're all bombed out. You don't know where you are 3 days later. And that's with everything.
How come you keep looking at me when you say that?
Pardon?
How come you keep looking at me when you say that?
I didn't know that. I didn't know I was looking at you. Guilty conscience.
What?
You don't want the pleasure to make you lose consciousness, do you? But do you? Most people use the pleasure to make themselves lose consciousness. Because losing consciousness is like coming alive. Being unconscious to their wrong is like being aware of their right.
You know, I, in connection to all of this, I've been thinking of this through the past several segments, that one time, a long time ago, and it's happened many times since with different friends, but I would be watching something of nature, typically a sunset, with a friend, a beautiful sunset, and I would look at it, and it was beautiful. And I would just look at it and see that it was beautiful. And my friend would go, "Oh, look at that sunset. That is the most beautiful sunset." And you could feel that he was pulling something out of that. And it seemed to me that related to what we were talking about women.
Exactly.
And imagine the pressure that this makes for a woman. We should be able to look at a woman and see that she's beautiful and not feel that we own it.
Or pull something out of her, to get something out of it that shouldn't really exist, and make her the object for obtaining that. Because one can become a sun worshiper and give power to the sun, and therefore you're not no longer ruling your own life, but to your life is now owed to the priests of sun worship. They can now dictate your existence, see, and it becomes weird and bizarre and okay.
You say a woman really doesn't want a man deep down. She really doesn't want a wimp of a man to give in to her sexual charms or whatever, but why does she continue to want to make him fall if she really doesn't want it?
Well, within every woman and within every man, there's two reciprocal dangling participles. There's two parts which make a whole in a very bizarre way. Two fallen beings. Now, man in his pure and an original state is not a creature that needs to draw feeling from anything, because everything that he is within him, unfolding. His roots and his senses are inward, and his environment is internal. That everything he needs to be and everything he is inbreathed. See? That is the mystery of what it really means to be human. And to the degree that you're not there, you feel lost or in conflict, a conflicted being because of it. Now, there's another being that has come from the fall away from that, and which is a mystery. It's the fall of man. And you know how I believe about these things. He's not a risen ape. He's a fallen being. And you can see this in your own life. Something wrong with the way you exist, and you don't know how you got here this way. Why is there something wrong with the way I exist? Aren't I evolving animal? And you try to adjust to this evolving animal theory, and you give in to your animal self, and what happens? You've got more conflict. You can never get rid of it if you've got any brains, don't you see? If you've got any sensitivity to the inner world, it never will go away. You're not destined to die a beast of the field, a gross, person without any beyond, except the grave, you see? So in a man that's fallen, the man has fallen to the environment. What is in the environment is the woman represents the outer and another within. See, man represents the environment of God and within, and woman represents, in their fallen state, the environment and that which lurks in the environment, operating through the woman. The serpent was the most subtle creature in the garden. The approach, he got into the woman to get into the man.
That original incident.
The original incident is still with us. See, because you see, man now becomes desensitized from the within, his own within, and becomes sensitized and recreated by the trauma of it from the without within. There's a within the woman too, a beyond. But this is the serpentine part which recreates man in its own image by original trauma. And now something comes from the woman that now grows in the man. And this man no longer is made over in the image of God, but is being slowly being made over in the image of woman.
Does he begin to identify with that?
He identifies with it, but he also identifies because now he's a sensuous man. Now everything he is external to himself. And that's why the spirit of drugs, the spirit of music, the spirit of even the spirit of medicine, which is really a mother, someone there, you're okay, there's nothing wrong with you, let's fix you. Is there no difference from the spirit of the drug pusher, is it? Attending to the symptom and making a person feel better without having to look at himself. Liberating him from conscience. So, you see, you've got syphilis, fine, we'll fix you, give a shot of penicillin. You don't have to look at yourself, no morals involved. Go ahead now and get AIDS. We'll cure that too. Liberating you from conscience to live the life, freeing you from the consequences of your ways, you see. Now,
one more, just one.
Yeah,
more
you know what I'm trying to point out? Let me make one little point, because it's so important that this spirit that opens man's senses and makes man inbreathe from the outside. You see, when a woman kisses a man. Now, what's kissing all about? Slobbering all over each other's faces. What is all that about? It is exactly the same. It is, if you look at it really carefully, is that man gets an inbreathed feeling. A woman is breathing into her the breath of her life, but really taking it out of him. After all, he feels drained. She don't feel drained, he does. See, because the life that's in the woman is dependent upon the man falling away from the life. Look, how can you eat a sheep without killing it? You can't, can you? You've got to kill it to eat it. So in a way that you have to devour the man, inbreathe, imbibe the man, you only by the way you can you assimilate him is to kill him. There's a fungus does the same thing. It cannot live on a perfectly healthy plant. If the plant should somehow become diseased, the fungus then takes over. It can only thrive on an unhealthy plant. So is a female attached in her fallen state, because to tempt is as much a sin of separation from God as to be tempted by the tempter. They're locked together, right? You tempt and you get a life of pride. The drug pusher tempts, teases, supports the pusher. The pusher falls for this, gives his soul, his life, his money, his substance, his energy to the pusher. The pusher now falls to the power of it, addiction. So this woman innately, inherently understands, even though she doesn't know what she understands. And these two forces, that which is fallen in a man, imprinted by a woman, is attracted to the woman. But the life of it is dependent on. Do you understand? His life is dependent on
I can also see how you, how every aspect of this society, how the government, you talk about the woman image, and a lot of these, the government even, how they give, the welfare comes in and they give to the poor and say, come now, and you know, the woman spirit.
It's the same spirit everywhere. Everything that seduces, that wants to help you with your rights, that loves you the way you are, that loves you the way you are, reinforcing the way you are, and you coming down to think of that as love, and in filling yourself with this lie, you're giving your life, you become debilitated in the process. Mm-hmm. As you become more debilitated, you need more love for the lie, which is your life. And it isn't love, it's a lie. Is that right or not?
Yeah, it's like the woman image comes through the government. You talk about the liberals, how they're saying give to the poor, we need more programs, welfare for this and more money, and the poor
get
poorer.
Serpent. That's the serpent. That's the serpentine nature. That's the female nature in all the politicians. They all understand the same thing.
What about the incentive program that they're trying to put through now to make the people that are on welfare, in order to, they want them to become
independent? Well, I can't discuss the merits of social programs.
Yeah.
I don't want to get into that. I want to stay within the confines of the principles that we're speaking about. And in that vein, I want to say that there lurks behind every glass of wine, every forbidden sexual experience, not within the parameters of morality, see? Holy matrimony, see? Spirit guided with love, with every piece of music experienced without temperance, maturity, every sunrise. There are even hippies, people who become so caught up with the feelings they can get from nature that they make nature their god, see? And they are totally absorbed into nature and become, well, nature people. They become Neanderthals living in the woods, drawing their life from nature and identity from the woods. So instead of, as I was saying in a couple of programs ago, that the Aborigines and the people are underprivileged, third world people who seem to be evolving from the slime, really are those people who have come back to it. If you look at the Egyptians, they used to be a great nation. Look at the Syrians, great empires. Just look at them now, look how they live. Look at the Chinese, great. You see them slide, you can actually see some of those. Those are good examples, but the Aborigines are not people who have not evolved, but have declined, devolved. Mankind is devolving. And you can see, even through our intellectual ways, we're still devolving. If you look at the average, if you look at the world today, look at America, do you see beautiful people? Only on the stage and scream, and maybe on Pismo Beach somewhere. There's a few of them get over there and show off their bodies, but mostly big, fat, degenerate, ugly slobs walk the streets. I mean, gross. I mean, permeated with AIDS and syphilis and gonorrhea. Every disease in the book, you don't even want to touch them, let alone kiss them. See, so what we have is an advance of medicine, advance of science. See, it's like it's science fiction. It's become a god. We're worshipping, and the decline of civilization. People are getting deteriorating. The more science we have to help us, the more they help us away from morality, the more we become dependent upon this gadget and that gadget, this life-saving device, this serum, this cure. We're becoming dependent while it's freeing us from being moral, independent, self-actuating, self-healing, self-motivating, God-serving. See, it's a system of things, and we're all caught up in this trap. And we're all dying. The more science, the more knowledge, the worse we become.
I like to hit the root of that problem. What the root was with me is I had unjust parents.
Who doesn't?
Well, I don't know anybody that doesn't, but I didn't know how to handle it. And like most kids, I turned towards resentment, and I thought that was a way of dealing with it. But strangely enough, when you come to resent something that's unjust,
you become injustice.
That's exactly. And it's like with my parents, I can see myself growing up and doing the same thing to my kids.
Of course.
And I see that within myself, all the bad characteristics that I hated in my parents,
they're in you.
They're in me now, and I'm dealing with them now.
Did you see now that the temptation lurks in your parent? It's already done your parents in.
Mm-hmm.
Now from its new home in there, it's going to do you in, because they're its victim, and you have to be their victim.
Well, it's trying to, but see, what I've learned to do through you and your teaching is every time it comes up, the resentment, I try to look at it. And I try to see what it's doing and catch it in the act. And it doesn't like being caught in the act, because what resentment does, it puts you to sleep.
It does.
And if you awaken to that resentment...
Remember what I said about excitement putting you to sleep in any form, pleasure or pain? It puts you to... It anesthetizes the conscience and allows the other self to slip in and grow, doesn't it?
It does.
See, it allows for that. That's why it's a perfect release.
And that's what happened to me. And that's what I'm dealing with now within myself. And I can see that this has happened to just about everybody. You know, everybody has unjust parents, and everybody's failed to deal with them in the right way.
But look at it. Look at it. Temptation has taken a hold of your unjust parents. Okay, your mother's real nature has been displaced.
It happened to her when she was a kid.
Exactly.
She didn't know how to deal with her parents.
And go back as far as you want to go. There's always a first mother and a first father. The failure of men has the failure of man, the hell of life has come through the woman through the failing of men, because once the first man falls from the grace, he has no power to stop the spread of iniquity in the world. Like the scripture says it perfectly, through one man, sin and the whole human race comes into being. But through one man, sin goes out, leaving the human race intact. See, the job's done. Sin and the whole human race. Through one man, Adam, sin, what you see in this world spreading like cancer, see, and multiplying, as people multiply, so does sin multiply, and the variations of wickedness multiply, see? So, through one man, sin and the whole human race came into existence. We all come into existence as fallen beings, through our mother. And every man fails. every single man from who's ever lived, except those very few enlightened ones, has inherited this this sting of woman, the serpent's sting, because there's no father to stop the stinger, to stand in the way. There's no light, there's no connection to God, because he's trying to be a God through the woman's love. He's always looking for this excitement, the stimulation, the sensuality of their relationship. He's always imbibing, inbreathing her excitement, her love. And losing himself in the lie that he's a man when he's a wimp, a man when he's a beast, a something when he's a nothing. And all men have suffered that. See, until, of course, the evolution of the beast as man reaches the point of conflict. See? Now, usually we drugs and alcohol and all kinds of things are wheeled in to increase our sensitivity to the world we live in. See, to drown our awareness and to anesthetize it, to put the conscience to sleep. But that's the very thing. That's our friend. We are taught that our conscience is our enemy, an appendage from some past prehistoric slime experience. See? We're taught that this is a social thing. It's not. You cannot get rid of your conscience. Get rid of it to your peril, because that's, you're dead. There are people in this world who are sociopaths and psychotics. Like Jim Jones and his followers, sociopath, psychotic. He creates an illusion of heaven. See? He dies, and nobody wants to live, because without him, they experience true heaven. The reality of heaven, which is they discover that they've been in hell all along, and they don't want to face it. They'd rather be dead than admit they're wrong, so they all die together. Their whole life revolves around an illusion which he provides for them. They are the sociopaths who have no conscience at all. They're totally back-to-front people. They come from another world, and the world is full of them, and you become psychotic through that. You see? Well, I'm just running out of time now, because there's no more questions. There's another half an hour went by, and I just hope to God that you're going to support the program and let me continue in this line of thinking, so that perhaps we can activate this thing called conscience, so that you become you're in line with it. It trickles down into you, so it becomes you, and so you become immune to the pressures and sensations of life. See, if you respond angrily, that's one form of becoming locked into the world and growing like an ego animal, rather in conflict with self. But then the pleasure, excitement, which seems to be the opposite. If bad makes you upset, therefore who soothes you and makes you feel good is good. No. Because you're still, pleasure does not neutralize. It does not neutralize what the cruelty of pain. There's cruelty behind pleasure too. There's cruelty behind love, if you've noticed it. See, because it keeps you failing. It keeps you from coming to terms with your real self. See that? Pleasure is not the opposite of pain. It's as much stress. It keeps you sensitized. So that when the pleasure is over and you feel good about yourself, you're still that much more sensitive to the world. More sensitive because of the pleasure than the pain. It sets you up for the next reaction to something cruel representing pain, which makes you go to the pleasure. Behind the pleasure, there's the same hell lurking, keeping you from learning how to deal with it, and keeping you from growing in the light of God to serve his kingdom and purpose on earth as it is in heaven. Thank you very much. Join us next week. We hope we're here. Send money, and we'll be here. Thank you very much, and join us again.
This concludes our program.